The ultimate field trip for teacher Christa McAuliffe will be her six-day voyage into space.
Even now, I still can't believe that I'm going to get into the shuttle and it's going to blast off.
We'll meet New Hampshire's Teachernaut tonight.
Julian Lennon realizes that comparisons between him and famous Father John are inevitable. But tonight we'll find out he's determined to achieve his own musical success.
Rio de Janeiro is a mecca for hedonists and partiers, and tonight we'll meet the party queen of Rio, Anna Maria. Friday's edition of Evening Magazine.
From the Buckingham Brown and Nichols Lower School in Cambridge, welcome to Evening Magazine. Hi, I'm Sara Edwards.
And I'm Barry Nolan, and this is the science room where these second graders have been learning about everything from teeth to magnets to volcanoes. Today they're studying about space and the space shuttle.
This is a model of the shuttle that one of the students, Morgan, created. Look, it takes off, has flames on it.
Very realistic.
Well, our first story tonight is about a woman who's taking the real shuttle into space. Her historic mission is scheduled for next week, and right now we meet the first teacher in space.
And the winner, the teacher who will be going into space, Christa McAuliffe. Where's is that you?
When Vice President Bush announced that Christa McAuliffe, a high school teacher from Concord, New Hampshire, would be the first private citizen to ride the space shuttle, it propelled her into the national spotlight. But that was only the beginning of a year-long odyssey filled with paparazzi, press conferences, and orientations that will transform her into the world's first teacher in space.
Even now, I still can't believe that I'm going to get into the shuttle and it's going to blast off. I was standing there with a flight suit on today, and I put the helmet on, and I was looking in a mirror, and I thought, God, I look just like an astronaut, you know? I mean, it didn't seem possible that that's really part of my life right now.
Before Christa steps foot on the Space Shuttle Challenger, she will go through a series of exercises that will acquaint her with life in the weightless environment of space. It will surely be an enlightening experience, but not without sacrifice. She will have to spend an entire year away from her husband, Steve, and their children, Scott and Caroline.
Love you.
That's a trade-off. I mean, we looked at this and we said, you have the opportunity to take this wonderful shuttle flight and have this extraordinary experience. And yes, you're going to be away from your family, and yes, that's going to be hard, and yes, my husband's going to be coming home a little early in the evening because he has to do those things, but that's a trade-off, and we decided that it was well worth it.
Your common, everyday, ordinary things like just eating, drinking, going to the bathroom, those kind of things are a little bit different in space, so you need some kind of training that prepares you for that so it's not a big surprise to you.
Astronaut Dick Scovey will be the commander of Christa's mission.
The requirements are becoming less and less stringent for flying in space. It's really not that dramatic or dynamic an environment. You have to go through the launch loads and everything, which is 3 G's acceleration through your chest, for instance, but anybody in halfway reasonable health can do that.
Christa, along with her alternate Barbara Morgan, has to be acclimated to the dizzying effects of zero gravity. So NASA has sent her up in a KC-135, known as the Vomit Comet.
I'm going more as an observer than I am as an actual integral member of the crew. There are two things that the commander told me to do, and he said, the first one, he said, I want you to have fun, and the second one, he said, look out the window.
On her six-day mission, Christa will be doing a lot more than looking out the window. She'll be teaching 3 20-minute lessons from space to students on Earth via satellite, complete with a question and answer period.
The space lessons are very simple. And the reason we made them that way was because we were trying to get, again, the younger children involved, plus something that would excite older students. And when we came up with the field trip in space, everybody wants to know what it's like to live on board the shuttle.
While all of these detailed preparations are being made for the historic flight, Steve McAuliffe has been back in New Hampshire holding down the fort.
Good girl. Okay. Frozen cook. If you've seen the movie Mr. Mom, it's I haven't found any differences. it's surprisingly like that movie. Yeah, for the last 15 years, I've heard that she's put me through law school. Every time things, you know, get a little out of balance in terms of the home chores, I always get the, don't forget I put you through law school. So at least now I'll be able to say, don't forget that year before you went up on the space shuttle. So this is great. This will even it out nicely.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4. We've gone from 8 to start.
The next time the space shuttle is launched, Christa McAuliffe will be on board. Her voyage will usher in a new era as space travel becomes available to everyday citizens.
I don't see my life as really being changed right now. I know I'm going to have a wonderful experience and something that few people, right now, have had that opportunity to experience. But I don't feel any different. I don't think I'm any less approachable. I see myself still as a teacher first. And that's important. And I hope that I keep that perspective because I do want to return to the classroom.
Gear down.
Well, I've been talking to my friends here at the Buckingham Brown and Nichols School who would love to go into space, like Christa McAuliffe. Now, Juliana, what about you? What would you hope to see if you went up there?
Some planets and definitely a shooting star.
Ooh, that would be great. How about you, Tammin?
I'd like to see the planets and especially the moon and just look around.
Just look around while you're up there. Well, I think we're going to have to live the experience through Christa McAuliffe. As a matter of fact, next Monday night, right here on WBZ TV4 at 8 p.m., there's going to be a special entitled Teacher in Space, an in-depth look at the life of Christa McAuliffe, starting with her childhood in Framingham and taking you all the way up to her pre-flight preparations. It's an adventure you won't want to miss. Well, coming up next on Evening Magazine, we'll meet a young man who's achieved musical success following in the footsteps of his famous father, John Lennon. Stay with us.
Sitting on a pebble by the river, playing guitar.
I was just talking to a couple of these second graders here about what their parents do. Some said doctors, lawyers, architects. Some said, I really don't know. And then I asked, who is your favorite rock star? And you two told me Madonna, right?
Yeah.
Would it be weird to you if Madonna was your mother?
Yeah.
Yeah? Yeah? How about you? Would that seem weird if Madonna was your mother and everybody?
Yeah.
It's kind of weird growing up to have a really famous parent that everybody knows. Especially difficult if you're following in their footsteps. Tonight evening's Dennis Elson talks to Julian Lennon.
Sitting on a pebble by the river, playing guitar.
If the look and sound of this British singer are strikingly familiar, it's because he's Julian Lennon, the 22-year-old son of John Lennon. The same year that the Beatles were topping the charts with Please Please Me, Julian was born to John and Cynthia Lennon. What was called the British invasion by us became an invasion of privacy for Julian throughout his childhood.
I first walked in the assembly hall, and the headmaster of all things comes in and says, stand up, you know, in the middle of hundreds, and said, we'd like to welcome John Lennon's son, Julian Lennon, here. So I'm going, oh no, this isn't going to be fun.
As the Beatles became more popular, Julian and his mother were kept out of the public eye to protect them as well as the band's teen idol image. And then in 1968, John and Cynthia were divorced. John's legendary marriage to Yoko Ono soon followed. The Beatles broke up, and John began recording on his own. Julian remembers a visit to his father's recording session of the album Rock and Roll, which turned into the 11-year-old's public debut.
I was walking in and waddling around and seeing what studios were like, and I was fiddling around with all the instruments, and then I started hitting the snare drum, and then Dad came in the studio and started singing, sitting in a lot, And so I only had one snare drum and a stick, and so I was trying to keep in time the best I could. And we didn't know that the engineer was taping it.
By the time Julian began taking his musical career seriously, his father's came tragically to an end when he was murdered in December of 1980.
I woke up and I just had a strange feeling, and I wasn't sure what it was. And I went downstairs, all the blinds were closed and everything. And, you know, all the press, I said, what are they here for, you know? And, I mean, it was a very sad moment, you know. I mean, my mother was away, my stepfather was there, and my mother told my stepfather, don't tell him until I get back, I want to break the news. But he did, you know, I sort of forced it out of him. And it was very heavy, you know.
Ever since you've been leaving me, I've been wanting to cry.
Although Julian is aware of the influence his father's had on his music and his life,
with his father's famous myopic eyes and fine wispy hair,
he's managed to get out from under his father's shadow with the success of his first album, Balot, which went platinum.
And it's much too late for goodbye.
And now Julian's released a home video called Stand By Me, A Portrait of Julian Lennon. It's a look at his first concert tour, done in a documentary style, blending onstage excitement, backstage candor, and an interview. Despite years of news stories and speculation about a bad relationship between Julian and Yoko, she and her son Sean accompanied him to the New York screening of that video.
We got back together after like a year or so of not speaking to each other. I think after the pain of Dad's death and everything, it affects people in certain ways. The way I look at Yoko, I think she's actually getting back to herself now. She's doing things she wants to do. She's finally becoming content and happy and relaxed.
Though he's making his own mark on the music world, Julian knows some people will always think of him only as John Lennon's son.
That'll never go away. It's going to be the outside people that are always going to say, the son of, you know. Whereas I think people who are closer to the Beatles or my father or whatever will recognize me as Julian.
Yes,
Julian Lennon plans a second U.S. tour in the near future, and how many of you kids have heard of the Beatles? Okay, shout out their names. What were their names? Shout out their names.
John.
Julian Lennon.
And Julian Paul Lennon. Bobby. And Paul McCartney.
George.
And
George.
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 Ten Carton. George Ten Carton. Yes, the famous Beatle George Ten Carton. A story about him next week. Coming up next, a story about the party queen of Rio. You're invited.
The second graders in this class are learning a little bit about geography and places they might want to visit one day. And of course, this is the time of year when many New Englanders are starting to visit the warmer places in the world for a great winter escape. And one of the most popular resort cities is Rio de Janeiro, where in a few weeks they'll start celebrating their famous carnival. Right now, Evening's Pam Thompson takes us there and meets a woman who makes sure the party scene continues year-round.
Rio de Janeiro is a city known for its never-ending nightlife and social whirl. But no party would come to life without the help and blessings of this lady, Ana Maria Tornaghi. She's Rio's mover, shaker, and best party maker.
I got a card from CBS, from the president of CBS, telling that Alan Carr was coming and also Steve Wood.
Okay, in a study filled with books, trinkets, and memorabilia, it's obvious Ana Maria knows the right people all over the world, and all the right people know her. Let's face it, how many of us have casual snapshots taken with the rich and famous, or taken by them, like this shot by actress Candice Bergen? That's why the elite wouldn't dream of throwing a party without first consulting Ana Maria Tornaghi. He's made a big business out of throwing the hottest parties in Rio. But now, to start a business like that, you already had to have a big circle of important contacts. already.
Oh, yes, of course, because not only social, of course, no? More on the business life. But this, I'm born among these people, so it's not that difficult. He sent me some records from him and from Neil Sedaka, and some pictures from the party I went at the Sedakas.
Anna Maria's day is filled with phone calls and meetings with her 10 assistants, finding out who can attend, who can't, what time, where. In other words, putting together the best unveilings, grand openings, and social events Brazil has ever seen. And since she works out of her home, she seems to always have time for her husband and her 8-year-old daughter, Maria. Tonight, Ana Maria is getting ready for a big bash at the beautiful Copacabana Palace for the Rock in Rio Festival. But this social queen's success took off 18 years ago in New York when she orchestrated an art show for a friend. She caught the eye of some prestigious friends of her father's.
So they saw one day with some artists, Liza Minnelli, who was a very good friend of mine. And another day he saw me with some bankers. You know, Dick Aldrich is a very good friend of my father. And so he thought I was doing some kind of public relations in New York. When I came back here, they called me and they asked me to organize a big lunch for about 4,000 people, a big barbecue on the south of the country for the president of Brazil. Whoa. I thought it was a joke, and he liked it, and he said it was very, very nice, and he said this to everybody. Then everybody came to me asking to do the more different things you can imagine.
What if two of your clients, let's say, decide to have an opening or a party on the same night, and they both want the same people? What do you do?
One day, I did six things on the same night, not on the same day, six. Some for the same people, some not for the same people. I just called the client before and I say, this one came before and it's ridiculous to do the same people on the same day, and they change.
Ana Maria is the toast of her parties. She takes care of all the details, from the food list to the guest list. In fact, once she's hired, even the client is treated like a guest.
He will say what he thinks, what he wants, and what he thinks is the good thing to be done and everything. I listen, I hear, I pay attention. I try to do exactly what he needs and not what he thinks he needs.
He's outside, are some people without invitation, what to do.
The names must be on the list.
Yes.
Even they have the invitation, the names are on the list.
Don't people drive you crazy, though, calling you on the phone saying, oh, Ana Maria, they're having this party, and I want to go to this party, and I didn't get an invitation to it. Oh, you've got to help me.
I have to say the truth, no? I promise. It's not very much, because I just say, I'm so sorry, because I'm sorry to say to someone, it's not possible, I hate it.
But she doesn't really hate it, not at all. For even though this job can be difficult, demanding, and yes, impossible at times, Ana Maria Tornaghi, the queen of the social world in Rio, is in heaven.
I love it. I love it.
Recently, a big international nightclub wanted to open up one of their clubs in Rio, and when the big night came, they were surprised that only 9 guests showed up. Apparently, they hadn't gone through Ana Maria first, and in Rio, that's a no-no. We'll come back with more Evening Magazine in just a moment.
Sara, I was just talking to some of these second graders here about what life was like when I was their age and how I thought it'd be so great to be able to go into space one day, but it's not likely to ever happen in my lifetime. And now, boy, by the time you are my age, just think how life will have changed. How long you suppose that'll be?
Whoa.
It'll be a whole new world. Trust me. They'll all have their own private space shuttles. But I do predict something else for the future, that we have a good show for you Monday night.
On Monday night, we take a look at the real Elvira, a wholesome kind of gal.
I think Elvira might be this person that's inside of me somewhere, you know, trying to escape, and did.
We'll take a look at the premier women's ice hockey team in the Northeast.
And then the story of the dog that sings.
We'll see the year's most newsworthy men and women at the Celebrity Apple Awards. So all that Monday night. Have a good weekend.
Take care.